Thanks a lot, and thanks for the opportunity to give this course here. I said that in the title of the talk was Faculty Points, an overview. Well, it's not going really to be an overview because my knowledge is limited, so I will focus on a couple of points on the Faculty Points that I know of, but I will give at least the definitions, right? So what are the Faculty Points? Because this is not so clear, there are several competing definitions, and I will go to it. So the classical setting, this is the following. Say we have a compact set here in C, and we have a collection of points in K. And we want to maximize the following product of mutual distances. And among all possible n tuples of points in K. So these are the set of points that maximize this distance, which is not unique necessarily, but any set, any collection of points which maximizes this product, these are called Fekete. So if zeta 1, zeta n maximize this, zeta 1, zeta n are Fekete. Okay, so alternatively, it's you can think of this as a take the logarithm of this quantity, and this is alternatively it minimizes the sum I small g of the log of 1. So just by taking the logarithm and the inverse, this problem of maximizing this thing is a problem of minimizing this. This logarithmic energy, right? And of course, this ties with very classical objects. If I here I take, if in this quantity one takes the root 2n over n minus 1, this is like the geometric, this is the geometric mean of these mutual distances. This is the called the diameter. Okay, and the transfinite diameter, this is converging as n goes to infinity, this is converging to the capacity of K. Okay. And well, this will be more or less equivalent. We are just computing this quantity here when we take the roots. And the problem that I would like to understand is, well, to consider several possible generalizations of these weighted generalizations when we introduce an external field to this energy, to this logarithmic, and how this is how this behaves in several variables, possible generalizations to several variables in manifolds too, and how these points, my main object of interest is what's the geometric position of these points. Okay, so what's the, when n is very big, asymptotically, how do they look like? I mean, this is, but first, just let me go to a very similar problem, which is most, possibly the most well-studied problem in this area, which is the equivalent problem in the sphere. So we have now the sphere in R3, and we have a set of points here, P1, P2, Pn. And we want to maximize the same quantity, no? Here I take the distance in R3. So the distance is the mutual distance in R3. The Euclidean distance in R3. and you want to know how these points are always putting the points in the sphere. Is it okay, Sasha? So equivalently, I want to minimize this thing. So in a sense, this is like you want to put points here. This is a problem like of placing. You have a set of n people who are enemies of each other, and they really hate each other, and you want to place them in the sphere. But as soon as the points are very close, this thing is going to explode, and this is the total the amount of hate that there is in the whole system that you want to minimize. So you want to put all the enemies very far from each other, in a sense. But the difficulty here is that the hate is long range. I mean, you do not only hate the people that are near you. You hate the people that even if they are far away, this is not decaying. This kernel does not decay very fast. So you really feel the influence. Any of these people is really feeling the influence of all the others, even if they are far away. They want to be far away from everybody. And you want to put these n people as far away from each other, right? According to this logarithmic kernel. So, well, that's the setting of the problem. It is known, if I look at this problem from this point of view here, or there, I can of course consider the minimizer among all probability measures. Supported on K. Okay, so I'm taking the infimum of these quantities among all probability measures in K. And this functional is known to have a minimum, and the probability measure that achieves this minimum, it's called the equilibrium measure. Measure that minimizes this. And this is a probability measure, and it is known that the Fekete points, no matter which Fekete points I pick, the Fekete points are like candidates for this minimizer, right? The Fekete points, if I take to any set of Fekete points, Fn, I associate the measure mu n to be 1 over n, the dielectric deltas at the points zeta I. This probability measure, and which is one of the competing probability measures, but these measures, since they are minimizing this among all the atomic measures of this type, what happens here is that this is a theorem that I won't prove this theorem, but I will prove a stronger version, right? So the Fekete points, as the number of points increases, they are weakly convergent to this equilibrium measure, which is the unique. Okay. So in the case of the sphere, the equilibrium measure that is just the normalized surface area here, right? So as the number of points zeta n here increases, what will happen is that the these electrons that repel each other will just the limit measure will be just the uniform measure along the sphere. But we wanted to be more precise on this. But more interesting than that maybe is the case of weighted. I'm more interested in the case of weighted Fekete points. And when I mean weighted, it's a similar setting like here, but now introduce some, that there's going to be some, I'm going to introduce some external field. So there is not only here, there is some energy coming from these points, so the mutual energy of these points, but now I'm going to introduce an external field here. Actually, here, this is already a weighted setting. Well, let's start by this case, looking at the stereographic projection. So I just look at the stereographic projection here in this, I transform this problem in the plane, right? So this distance here, remember, was the distance in R3. So if I look at the points here, so zeta 1, zeta n are the points in C which corresponds to the points P1, Pn in the sphere by the stereographic projection. So this quantity, the logarithm of the distance, well, the distance here, P minus Q, is just the zeta, say, P1 minus P2 is zeta 1 minus zeta 2, the square root of minus zeta 1 square. This is the chordal metric. It's just the distance induced in the plane from the stereographic projection. And that means that we are minimizing here, the problem that we are minimizing here is the following. We want to minimize among all configuration of points, zeta 1, zeta n, this product, or maximize this product. Which corresponds to minimizing n times the logarithm zeta I, zeta j. So what? So this problem of finding this thing here corresponds to a problem of minimizing a problem where we have some logarithmic interactions and we have some external field here. So this, in general, this problem now is the following. So the general problem is the following. We are given V. V is going to be some positive external weight . There are some regularity assumptions that I need to make, upper semi-continuous, but I will work just with the smooth setting. So V is going to be smooth, and with a certain growth at infinity, actually, let's pretend that this goes faster. As X goes to infinity, it goes faster than a logarithm, and we want to minimize the following problem. We call this energy. Call the energy omega x1 xn. So the Fekete points are the points that minimize this this thing here. One has to understand this as two competing things. This V of X is something which is exploding at infinity. So because if I add more and more points in the plane, and here I'm not putting any more a restriction. Before I was restricting my points to be in a given set K. And here I'm not putting any restriction. A priori, the points could be in the plane. But of course, if I don't put anything here, any external field, I mean, these points will just repel each other and go to infinity, all of them. I mean, that's what they would like to do. But at the same time, if the points, this is preventing this from happening. This V is exploding at infinity, and it penalizes, it confines all the particles in a certain region. Okay? And again, the problem is try to understand when n goes to infinity, how the particles are, in which situation the particles are. Of course, this case is a particular case of that one, where V is just plus infinity outside K and zero in K. I mean, I could reduce the standard case to this one formally, yeah, but not on what I'm going to say, because I'm going to work with a smooth, but you could a priori, everything could be done in this context. So this is the problem that we want to study, the situation of this. Again, we can work with a weighted equilibrium measure. We could, I mean, if you divide by n squared here, if you divide by n squared here, you may think of this as, okay. Divide by n squared here, this is not, the minimizer is the same, and you may think that this is just a probability measure. So I want to minimize over all probability measures of the integral right. So this quantity has a unique minimizer. This it minimizes a probability measure, and the Fekete points, the same result holds. So the Fekete points in this case will converge to some equilibrium measure. The equilibrium measure here will, I will give some examples, but typically it's not like in this setting where it was living on the boundary, but it say if V, for instance, is in a, say an example, if V of X is the modulus of X squared, then here the equilibrium measure will be just the characteristic of a disk. The characteristic, so these Fekete points will live in what's called the droplet, and on a compact set where the equilibrium measure is supported. So that's what we would like to understand. So the main object of this talk is in which sense this mu n converges to this equilibrium measure, and what's the geometric configuration of the points. I would like to know what's the geometric configuration for always asymptotically. When n is very big, I would like to know what's the geometric, how do they look like, these Fekete points. Depending, of course, on the weight V. Okay, and before embarking on this, let me try to give some motivations. Well, first, there is one motivation just by itself. I mean, you want to know, this is a problem like in electrostatics. You have some external field, you have some electrons, you want to know how they look like. So this is a problem in potential theory, classical potential theory, that I think it's of interest itself. Another problem comes from here. You want to have a lot of points which are very uniformly distributed in the sphere. The Fekete points are a good candidate for them. I mean, they are going to be points which are very uniformly distributed. It's not clear how to place n points. The Fekete points may help. The problem is that the computation of this minimizer, even in this case, if you want to compute numerically this is extremely hard. I mean, if you want to do this, the number of, as n is very big, the number of variables is very big. This is a functional that has many local minima. So if you want to do this numerically, you fall very quickly in a local minima, which is not a global minima. And it's very hard to know what's, computationally, this is not easy task. I mean, there has been work done, but not for very big n. Hmm? But I would like to point out some other possible applications. Some motivation. I will at least give a couple. The first one is a problem on it's a problem in approximation theory. In the sense that I want to, one wants to construct a, rather approximation theory. That's not maybe there. It's a, we want to want, no, approximation is not the right word here. I want to construct numerical integration formulas. Say I have, we are given a set and a measure. And I want to, it could be in Rn. And I want to build a numerical integration formula to compute this. Well, the typical thing to do will be just to place some points and some weights. And say, well, I just take this. But then, how one must choose the points and the weights? Well, typically one imposes that this is thing is an equality when you have, for instance, a collection of polynomials, right? So you impose equality, you impose that this is an equality when these are polynomials. Say we are in, now I'm working in for say take zeta to the j. And you want this. Now I take zeta to the j, and I want that this is an equality. So I compute these things, assume that I know how to compute these things, and I just find out which is the right weight. Once I have fixed the points, I assume that I have fixed the points, I have to I find the weights out from this linear equation. But that means that in order to be able to solve this, and this this system must be compatible, right? So that this determinant should be different from zero, and it will be better if it's even not from a numerical point of view, that it's not just different from zero, but as big as possible. So one would like that this determinant is big in order that this these weights are numerically well defined. And the determinant, this is a van der Mond determinant, which is just this product. So what I mean is that if these points, this determinant is big, these points are a good candidate for being nodes in a numerical integration formula. So Fekete points are good points to make numerical integration formulas. So that's one one possible application. They are also good points for interpolation, as we will see. But let's move to another possible motivation, and this comes from random matrix theory. And some problem in statistical mechanics. I mean, in the model, what's sometimes called a Coulomb gas, a Coulomb gas or one component plasma. These are physical models of particles that repel each other, and the distribution of these particles, I give you the joint intensity. The joint density of these particles is given by one normalizing factor times the exponential of minus beta times exactly that quantity here. So this is the probability distribution of n particles which repel each other. Zeta n is just a constant taken in such a way that this is a probability measure. Okay? And beta, as with Professor Nikolsky mentioned, this is usually the inverse of beta is called the temperature in this physical. Okay, and now let's pretend that we are freezing, so that the temperature is dropping to zero. Yeah, so beta is going to infinity. Now, all the points when the temperature drops, they somehow crystallize. What's the most likely event that this will happen? I mean, we look at this thing. This is just the density. The Fekete points are the points where the density function is bigger. So when this is bigger, so the maximum of the density is are the Fekete points. So when beta is going to infinity, everything is converging to these Fekete points. So what I mean is that for beta close to infinity, the distribution of these points is going to be close to that one. But even for beta finite, even for a beta finite, this there is a phenomena here of concentration of measure that we will see, which is happening. What's happening here is that most of the probability is very close to the median or to the mean. So what's happening here is that if I know the distribution of the Fekete points, if you know the distribution of the Fekete points, I will know the typical distribution of some particles following this Coulomb gas law. And so we will see that we will first get some information on the Fekete points, and once we know how the Fekete points behave, we will know how points with this probability distribution behave. So this will help us to understand these Coulomb gases. And there is one particular case of interest, which comes from random matrix theory, which is the case, say, the temperature now beta is equal to 2. Okay, so let's take the temperature here, beta equal to 2. Now, there is a model, say, for instance, the Ginibre ensemble. This zeta n, well, is just the integral of this. Yes, it's the partition function, that's called, yeah. This is just to normalize it. It's a problem, actually, it's a not trivial problem to estimate what's the size of this n, this capital N and the little n are the same n, sorry.
Exactly the same formula as
this. Yeah, exactly, but here the interaction is with all the points, not just for with the neighbors. This is what I was saying about these long range interactions, not that that's hidden here. So what I So the Fekete points, well, the only observation is that Fekete points are the mode of this probability distribution. And a lot of points here will fall very close to the mode. Now, the next thing, well, there's one particular instance which is of interest. Say, for instance, take V of zeta to be the modulus of zeta square. So this is one example of this, and beta equal to 2. Then this probability distribution arises not only from this Coulomb-Gauss problem, but also in some random matrix ensemble. So this this arises, this probability distribution, in the Ginibre ensemble. What's the Ginibre ensemble? The Ginibre ensemble is the following. I take an n by n matrix and all the entries I take them, you just flip a coin. I mean, take them independent one from each other. I mean, it could be really, a priori, the easiest case is when I just take a normal. Normal distributions centered at zero, variance one, but independently distributed, all of them identically independently distributed. And then I have this matrix A. And now you look at the spectrum of the matrix. So now you look at the eigenvalues of these, the eigenvalues of these matrices, denote by zeta 1, zeta n, the eigenvalues. What happens is that this theorem of Ginibre says that the eigenvalues of A have exactly this this probability distribution. So they have this probability distribution. The probability distribution is the product of zeta I minus zeta j square times the product over j of e to the minus zeta I square. Well, not exactly, it has this one. But well, and there is some normalizing factor that I skip. But this is the density distribution for the eigenvalues of A. And this is just a matter of computation. This is what Ginibre did. His theorem says that the eigenvalues have the distribution. Now, if you draw them, and this is easy to draw, just take an n by n matrix at random and make and compute the eigenvalues and draw them. You will see, if you draw them, you have, there will be points uniformly distributed in a disk of center zero and radius square root of n. There may be one or two away here, and then there will be none. I mean, just pick them at random, I mean, it will be like this. And here, they will be very uniformly distributed, and moreover, they will never be touching each other. There will be, there is a local repulsion of the eigenvalues. The local repulsion, you can see it already from here, because you see, when zeta I is equal to zeta j, the density is zero, right? So that means that it's very unlikely that two points are together. So this is the typical distribution, right? If I rescale things down by a square root of n, so that things live in a in a disk of radius 1, so just change variables. Sorry, the other way around. When you rescale variables, well, this square root of n, this will be an n here, and this will be exactly this n. So we will land exactly on this problem. Okay? So we will have the probability distribution will be this one after rescaling. And what will happen is that the equilibrium measure corresponding to this problem, the equilibrium measure corresponding to this weight V, is exactly the characteristic of the unit disk times the Lebesgue measure. And what's happening is that the Fekete points are going to converge to this equilibrium measure for this problem, and that means that here the problem after rescaling they will just look like as you see in the pictures. I mean, but this is just for the Fekete point, which is the point with is the most likely point, but not but as I was saying, there is a concentration of measure that helps you here. Okay, so this helps to understand understanding the Fekete points will serve to understand points in the Ginevra ensemble. There are other ensembles. An ensemble, I don't know why they choose this French name, but this is just a set of matrices with a certain probability measure on it, right? There is this has been extended, this thing here, to other weights. To other weights this is some work that was done by Amer, Hedelman, and Makarov, which was an extension of this random matrix model for the Ginevra ensemble to other ensembles, which are normal matrices. So we have a matrix which is normal, and I can write any matrix which is normal. It can be written as a unitary diagonal, and I can, among the if A is normal, I can think of them. This is like a Riemann manifold. Among all this in between, inside the spaces of all matrices n by n, and here there is a volume, the Riemannian volume inherited from this from this sitting in R n square is the following. So the standard volume measure in the normal matrices is, well, like the Haar measure for the unitary group here, and here the product of lambda I minus lambda j square dm. No, that's not correct. This is, square the van der Mond determinant times dm of lambda 1. Okay, so this is the natural probability on the, not the natural measure on the normal matrices. And now one take the following. So take phi, an arbitrary function. Well, say, let's take a real analytic to now one defines a probability measure on the space of matrices in the following way. You just take in the exponential of the trace of phi of m times the measure, this volume measure, this is a probability 1 divided by 1 over zeta n. This is a probability in the space of normal matrices, probability measure. And now, so for given, for any weight, I will have a different probability measure. So now, pick one random matrix according to this probability distribution. And now we look at the spectrum of this matrix with this probability distribution. This will again give rise to the same probability distribution that we were considering before. So now these are the lambda 1, lambda n, is the spectrum of a matrix which you pick with this probability distribution, and this is this thing. Times a normalizing factor. So what I mean is that the weighted, this is exactly the, well, this is the density. So what I mean is that the maximum of these things, so this was the exactly the weighted Fekete point, the point which maximizes this, the Fekete points, maximize the probability, the probability density. Okay, so this is another instance of random matrix theory where the eigenvalues satisfy some law which has maximum density exactly on the Fekete points. And again, if we understand the Fekete points, we will understand better how the spectrum of these random matrices look like. Okay, so that's the that was the motive, well, another possible motivation. Okay, we will, oh dear. Okay, I stop with the motivations because otherwise we won't have time for the results. I was planning to give some results now and to give at least one proof, and then during the next hour, and then tomorrow to give some applications to these other settings of these theorems. Okay. So now we will work in the following setting. So we will actually move to the most general setting. Sorry, not this. So now the general problem, which will a priori collect all these possible, all these variants. The general problem is the following. We have M is going to be a compact complex manifold. Dimension n. L will be a holomorphic line bundle over M. So in each point in M, I have a complex line. And I will consider the holomorphic sections, I don't know how to note it, H of These are just like the functions, the holomorphic functions, because this is a one complex. Locally, this looks like functions here in this line bundle. And we have a metric on this line bundle. So that means that well, if locally here I have here is my manifold M, and here locally the any section will just be any section here, any section of the holomorphic line bundle will be just an holomorphic function in this neighborhood times some given frame. This is just any E of zeta is any given section, and any other section is just F of z times this thing here, and the size of S of zeta in this metric will be just the modulus of F of zeta times e to the minus phi of zeta. So phi of zeta is a collection actually of functions given in patches here, no? In a coordinate system, so in such a way that the size of a section in a point is just the modulus times this. So here you see the weight is not optional. I mean, it's built in the construction. It's the only way to measure the size of a section. It's through this weight. Now, what's the Fekete point in this context? Okay. We take a basis of sections, of holomorphic sections, S1, Sn. So these are sections on this holomorphic line bundle. Let's think of functions. And now you take the determinant at take n points and take the determinant of these sections. And you measure it in the natural metric here. And if this is maximal, then the points zeta 1, zeta n, these are Fekete points. Okay, so this is the definition of Fekete points. But now, where is the degree? The degree here is that instead of, before we had n, the number of points was increasing, and here everything is fixed, because we have the holomorphic line bundle, and the number of points, of Fekete points, apparently only depends on the dimension of the space of sections. So the point is that here we are going to take now powers of this line bundle. So we take powers of this line bundle, tensor products, and this thing here, the dimension of this thing increases. The dimension of the sections here is typically, it's about k to the n. So now we will have for each power k, we will have a collection of Fekete points in the manifold M, and so Fk will be Fekete for Lk. And we would like to know where these Fekete points distribute. Okay, this seems a bit abstract, but let me just make it this concrete for you, so you will see that we have all the cases that we had were, but just one special case. So, and this is the case that you have to keep in mind all the time, because though it's trivial, it's interesting enough. some special case to keep in mind. So take, for instance, M, which is just CP1, the Riemann sphere, and L to be the tautological line bundle. In this case, if you have the tautological line bundle and you take powers here, the space of sections are just the polynomials. So H, the space of sections here, are isomorphic to the homogeneous polynomials in C2, which when I regard them in CP1, you just think of polynomials of the Greek A, homogeneous polynomial of the Greek A. So when I look at them here, this set is also, well, it's just in one variable, this is just the space of polynomials of the Greek smaller than K. So here we have just the polynomials of the Greek smaller than K. And what's the size? The size of a polynomial here, in this, if here we have a metric e to the minus phi, in the tensor product, the metric is e to the minus chi phi, which here it will be the size of a polynomial in a given point, in a polynomial of degree K, the size of in K phi, this is equal to the absolute value of P of zeta divided by the 1 plus zeta square over K halves. So this is just the size of the polynomial. And this determinant here, well, this is just this determinant. Times, since we are taking this power phi here, we are taking this means that we are dividing here by the square root of this thing. K halves. So the Fekete points in the manifold CP1 with the tautological line bundle correspond exactly to the points which maximize these points in the plane, which this was the spherical metric. Thus, this means that we are considering the Fekete points in the sphere. So the Fekete points in the sphere are exactly one particular case of these ones. But we have Fekete points now in an arbitrary manifold in CN, defined in this way. But this is just a particular, this is one particular case. And the aim is to give, oops, sorry. I just announce what we will do in the next hour. The aim is to obtain the distribution, to measure the distribution of the Fekete points, for instance here, to the uniform, how they are close, the Fekete points at level n, to the uniform distribution in the sphere. And the way of measuring it will be the two different ways. This one way is using the Kantorovich distance. The Kantorovich distance measures the distance in between two probability measures. We will measure how close the Fekete points are to the uniform distribution. And the other is by discrepancy. We will look at a given disk, D, and we look how many points are Fekete points are in this given disk with respect to how many points we will expect if it was completely uniform. And we will measure the discrepancy in this way. So we will quantify this convergence to the equilibrium measure in this setting. Okay, so I'll stop here.
Are there questions?
And Fekete himself, so he introduced it for
I think it was in the plane without weights. If a good reference for the one-dimensional setting in the plane, there is a book by Saf and Totic on weighted logarithmic potential theory, and which is the standard reference for the one-dimensional thing. And this is what I'm going to explain now. It's something which has been developed in the last, say, 10 years in these several complex variables.
Well, it's time to speak again.